Calendar. Every day we have appointments, and today's session is about how to manage your calendar in the best possible way. Time is important. All the time we are blocking time. What is the difference between appointment and meeting? Both block time, but in appointment, I am going to do whatever I want in that time. That's appointment. Whereas in a meeting, I'm going to add other people also, and they're going to get a meeting invite. Both happen in calendar. So let's go to Outlook calendar. I'm sure you already go there, and you know there are four views available. One day at a time, 1 week at a time, 1 month at a time, and work week means what? Excluding the holidays, typically Saturday, Sunday, but you can customize it. I hope you know how to customize file options calendar, and then you can choose the working days and non-working days. That's all there is to it. Many companies follow weekly calendar. So first week to 52 weeks, they have some plan. Generally, we don't see the number of the week in the calendar, but you can enable it by going to File, Options, Calendar and enable this option. And this is how it will look. What I want to do is I want to see all Mondays for this month in sort of a week view. So what is a week view? One day gets one vertical line. Like that, I want Monday, 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 Monday. Can you do that? No. You can actually click on the first Monday, then control click, control click, control click. There you go. You can choose which days you want to show. Need not be in the same week, same month, across months also. So maximum you can put 14 dissimilar, discontinuous or non-contiguous dates. Even if you choose them in random order, they will still be arranged in chronological order, but you can have 14 different dates being shown at the same time. Every Monday we have our top management meeting, and I want to manage that day properly together. Another example could be on the last Friday of every month, we have review meetings and you want to manage them across months. So this is where random selection of dates is really useful. Another very common problem is many people want to do some bulk operation on the calendar. Bulk means what? I want to delete 20 appointments, or I want to delete all the appointments before a particular day or year. How do you do that? Because either you see 1 week or 1 month. Beyond that, what do you do? So the idea is, yes, it is possible. You don't have to do anything manual. Go to the View tab. View means it controls what you are seeing. That's the view. So go to the View tab, change the view from calendar to list. And now it just becomes like a list. And now you can sort, filter, delete, do whatever you want in a bulk mode. And by the way, here, if you select copy and paste, you can actually paste it in Excel as a table. There is another view called schedule view, but we'll see that later. How do you block time? Yeah, either you create the appointment or someone sends you a meeting request and then you block it. But how does it look? There are two ways of changing the look and feel. One is categorization, and the second is the status, means the type of blocking. Am I free or am I busy? Or I'm free, but I'm physically not in office. I'm working from elsewhere. Remember, that's a very interesting option in today's hybrid scenario, right? And then of course, out of office and tentative. Now let's do a quiz. On the left side, you're seeing time. Currently it's 1 hour at a time. If I right click, I can change that unit. So what is it? 30 minutes, 15 minutes, 10 minutes, 5 minutes. Oh, there is a 6 minute. Really? If 5 is already there, why do you need 6 minutes? And that's the quiz. Put your answers in the comment. Now let's see how to block time and create appointments and meetings. It's quite easy. You already know it, but I'm going to show you many methods. Maybe some of them you don't know, but they're useful to you. So when you're blocking time in calendar, you have to decide, am I blocking just the date or date plus time? If it is date plus time, be in the day or week view. That way you can see the day as well as the time. And then click where you want to start the appointment. Just type what you want and then press enter. That just blocks the time. You can extend it by dragging it as well. In month view, if you do the same thing, then it is going to be an all day event. Then of course you can change it, but by default, month view, new item, all day event. In week view or day view, you specify the time upfront. Now here is another very common scenario. There is a long mail trail going on. There is difference of opinion. People are shouting at each other on mail. And you say, okay, let's forget all this. Let's do a meeting and finish it off. Now what do you want to do? You don't want a blank meeting. You want all the people in that mail trail to be there in the meeting. And you want the context of the meeting also to be there in the calendar entry. And that is done very easily by dragging the mail and dropping it on the calendar icon. because you're reading the mail. Calendar is not open. That's okay. Just drag the mail, drop it on calendar icon, and it gives you something. It adds all the people. It puts the subject, it puts the body text, and now you just set the date time. Very easy to finish off long mail trails with a meeting. What happened just now, the original mail is still there and you copied the content into a meeting. If you don't want that, drag, but while dragging, press the right mouse button. And then it will give you these options. You choose whatever is most relevant to you. I'm sure you have seen the tasks best practices video. If not, the link is above. Now there, what are we talking about? How to execute work. And to execute work, we need time. You already have a task in your task folder. Just drag and drop it on calendar. But in this case, I want to block the date and time. So make sure you have the calendar open. You are in day or week view. The desired day is already visible. And then drag and drop. Okay, do you work across time zones? If yes, this will be very useful to you. If no, you can skip to the next topic. By default, we can see only one time zone. But if I want to arrange appointments with people from other time zones, you have to manually calculate what is my time, what is their time. It's difficult and not very convenient. The solution is very simple, actually. Go to the day or week view, right click on the time and say change time zone. Now you have two more time zones you can add. This is Outlook desktop on Windows. So maximum three time zones you can add. So choose the time zone and make sure you give a short name because that's going to be visible on the left side. And what is the benefit? You can see all the time zones together and you can see the working time, non-working time in a different shade of color. So it's much easier visually to figure out what is the optimal time. So that's one good use of multiple time zones. In web version, go to the wheel, choose time zone, and you can add up to six time zones on the web version. The other requirement is I'm already creating a new meeting. I am about to choose the time, but then I realize, oh, this is my time. I want time from New Zealand. What do I do? There is a time zone checkbox there. Enable the time zone checkbox. Now you'll see time zones. Now choose New Zealand time zone. Now you decide the time based on the convenience of the other party. Save. Now it's automatically going to translate and it will show in your calendar as per your time. The disadvantage of this is only one target time zone can be seen. Let me tell you a joke about reminders. I hope you know 15 minutes before every meeting you are going to get a reminder and they pile up. So what happens? Every day we start Outlook is going to show you a long list of reminders. And do you know what is the most common action? Dismiss all. Read those sentences carefully and then you'll understand the joke. On a serious note, reminders are always going to be there, but it doesn't mean you always keep it at 15 minutes. You know what is the meeting about. You know, is it across the building? It's right there. Is it online? Or you have to travel for 2 hours. So according to that, you should consciously change the reminder time. Otherwise, that reminder being there has no meaning whatsoever. And in case you don't need reminder, you can switch it off also. Nowadays, many meetings happen in hybrid mode. Someone is online, someone is in person. So Teams meetings. There is a button called Teams meetings, but once you click the button, it's going to add the link automatically. Rest of it remains the same. But there is one important thing many people miss out on. As soon as you create a Teams meeting, there is a button. Notice it. It's called meeting options. Very important. Most organizations have some defaults for those options. And generally, in a given situation, those defaults are not good. Now, you as the organizer are not just supposed to block time and invite people. It's your responsibility to make sure the meeting is configured properly. It's equally a part of your job. So understand these options. Think of what the kind of meeting is, how many people, what are they supposed to do, and then choose the right options. For example, who can bypass the lobby? If you know all the top management are going to come for the meeting, enable lobby is bad. You should disable the lobby. Whereas if you're expecting lots of people, some of them may be unauthorized, then you enable lobby. So it's a discretionary decision. Default is never going to be optimal. So at least for important critical meetings, look at it and customize it to your advantage. Now let's talk about recurring meetings. Most common example is reviews happen periodically or planning meetings. Or top management comes together for strategy meetings, happens monthly, quarterly, sometimes weekly, whatever it is. So you go to a meeting and click on the recurrence button. Look at that dialogue and study it a little because it's a complex dialogue. Complex in the sense there's day, week, month. So too many options. So what do you do there? You choose the frequency and then you decide what you want to do. So I'm going to show you some examples of a daily meeting versus a weekly meeting versus a yearly meeting. Once you have finished it, all the instances will be shown in the calendar, as you can see here. Now, when you double click on one of them, it's going to ask you a question because it doesn't know, do you want to adjust this particular one or you want to adjust the entire series? For example, in this case, I just dragged the duration or increased the duration of one instance of the meeting. It didn't ask me anything because it understood it is only that instance I'm covering. But if it thinks there is a choice, then it'll ask you only this one or the series, and you accordingly choose the option. What is new is you should stop using recurring meetings. What should I use? Before I answer that, you should understand why I'm asking you to stop recurring meetings. What is recurring meeting? The same people are going to come to discuss, debate, operationalize, do something about some common topic which has a long-term context. So apart from the meeting, whether it is monthly, weekly, quarterly, there are going to be files, there are going to be discussions, there are going to be action items. Where is all that going to happen? In that calendar entry? No, that calendar entry is just helplessly blocking each other's time. The coordination, the collaboration around that recurring meeting is going to happen in the dumping ground called inbox. And that's how you and everyone else are making everyone else's life miserable. So to avoid that from happening, this is your chance for improvement. Next time you are arranging a recurring meeting, stop doing it and create a team for it. Once you create a team for every meeting, you will have a channel inside. You can discuss there. You can have meetings there as well with all the benefits of the meeting. But entire coordination follow-up, not a single mail will go to anybody else. Bottom line, no more recurring meetings. The right way is create a team in teams and live happily thereafter. You need to decide what categorization you need. As an organizer, you need to track who is attending, who is refused, who has not even responded. Your calendar is empty. What is the other person thinking? Oh, this guy has nothing to do. May I say, wait, no. Really? That color coding stays with you mentally throughout Outlook. How do you share your calendar? Screenshot or export to Excel, copy paste? No, there are many nice ways of sharing your calendar. I already saved you time, no? So spend some of that to click on the subscribe button, bell icon, like, share, and there is a thank you button as well. Have a look at it. Take care. Bye-bye.